Hello, my name is Richard Jakob-Hoff and I'm the Manager of Conservation Science and Research here at Auckland Zoo. Well, I've been doing this work for a long time. So I used to be a zookeeper before I was a vet. I left school at the age of 16. I became a zookeeper as soon as I left school because I was nuts about animals. But the thing about working with wildlife was that we know so much about domestic animals. We know so little about wild animals. And I was just thirsty for knowledge. Well, I first met a kākāpō in 1990 when we were the first place to actually hatch a kākāpō in captivity. And when she was old enough, she was transferred to an island in the Marlborough Sounds. And one time when I was doing the veterinary work here, I was asked to go and have a look at her because people were worried about her health. And so I got to helicopter over to that island, and we were looking around for her in the bush, and then we spotted her in a tree, and I just stood still, and she made her way down the tree and then walked over towards me and started playing with my shoelaces. And I just thought, these birds are so gorgeous, they're so intelligent, they're curious, they're mischievous sometimes. So yeah, you can't help to love them if you meet them. So kākāpō have this condition, we all call it crusty bum. There's a proper name for it, which is vent dermatitis and cloacitis. They excrete all their wastes through the one hole, but they also use that same hole, which is called the cloaca, to lay eggs and to mate. So it's very, very important for them. But in this condition, they get an infection that causes sores, and it's very, very painful. And you see these scabs forming around it, and that's why we call it crusty bum. There are only 148 of these birds left in the world. We know that it can make them sick. We know that it's painful enough sometimes to stop them eating. And if that happens and they don't get found early enough, they can actually die. So potentially it's a really nasty disease. But we still haven't yet found out exactly what starts it, the why. What are the factors that make some birds get it and some birds not?
Boy.
We know we have to treat the infection, and kākāpō don't actually like being in a confined space very much, and so they'll often stop eating. And so a big part of their care is actually just feeding them, and we have to use a tube quite often to feed them. But every case is a little bit different, and so some need much more intensive treatment than others. As well as the veterinary care that we give the birds that come to the hospital, our vets also and nurses go out to the islands to provide veterinary support. And also some of our keepers have now been trained to help with changing transmitters that all of the birds wear, and also to mind the nests. Every nest is monitored. And so there are skills involved in observing the nests and then going and checking on the chicks and making sure they're healthy. Kākāpō actually are not particularly fertile. They only have something like a 50% fertility rate, and not all of those fertile eggs hatch and become fully grown. They don't breed every year. And so, you know, they're really fighting a battle to try to increase their numbers. For me, if we had a really healthy, big population of kākāpō, it would be like my life's work has been worth it. There's no other bird like them in the world. They're very specific to New Zealand. They're kind of part of what makes New Zealand, New Zealand. There's now less than half the wild animals in the world that there were when I was born. That's just in my lifetime. And I feel that not only a passion, but a strong responsibility to do whatever I can during my lifetime to change that situation, to start to reverse that decline, and to start to learn how to live with wild animals and live with nature instead of trying to dominate it. And contributing new knowledge through research is incredibly rewarding. You feel like a pioneer, and you can do it every day. I'm very, very lucky.